give notice from various crews around the church that it was a wedding here on Friday, and it was a joyous occasion. It's really nice to see the church being used properly again. Lovely to see you all here though this morning. Just a reminder to keep booking in. It's working very well, the system. Either phone me with your phone number or email me. My details are on the boards outside. I'm very pleased to welcome this morning to lead our worship Reverend Ian Wotherspoon. Ian has had a very large number of charters in his life, but ended up at Coatbridge, and he was there for 10 years until he retired in 2004. Having a wife who came from Fife, they retired back here very sensibly, and he now lives in Cooper and is very involved in St John's Church there. He has 3 grown-up children, 4 grandchildren, and his hobbies include joinery and playing the bagpipes. But I don't think you've got your pipes with you today, Ian. No, sadly not. Maybe next week, who knows?
Don't.
Oh, right, okay. I know someone else like that. Thank you for leading us in worship, and you'll be here again with us next week, which will be the last week before Justin comes back from his leave. So welcome, and thank you for being here.
Thank you very much for these words of introduction. I'm delighted to be with you this morning. It's a thrill to be able to conduct a service, to worship with you. I was looking up, and the last time I conducted a service was way back in October of last year, so you'll have to forgive me if I'm a wee bit rusty this morning. But it's lovely to be here, and a privilege, as always, to worship with God's people and to experience that love of God which is generated when we meet together. I'm going to start off now with a verse from Isaiah chapter 40 and there at verse 11. Like a shepherd he will tend his flock, and with his arm he will keep them together. He will carry the lambs in his bosom and lead the ewes to water. A very familiar image of God, the shepherd. But what lovely words these are, the shepherd tending his flock. Warren said I had quite a number of parishes in my history. Two of them especially were rural parishes, one in Ayrshire, one in the Borders. And sheep and shepherds were very much part and parcel of the whole thing. And at lambing time, if you went into a farmhouse, there was usually a wee lamb in a cardboard box up against the agar, recovering and hopefully getting back to life and being able to run and jump and play in the fields. So there's God's picture. The shepherd who cares for his flock, who goes with them and keeps them together, and leads them to water. Water of life. Without water, there's no life. So all of these things are part of the character of a loving and gentle and gracious God. And let us think about that for a moment or two in silence now. I would say let us worship God, but I'm afraid with the pandemic and all that it has brought, we can no longer sing together. What a shame that is. But we're going to listen to Richard as he plays the tune for hymn 44, Praise Waits for Thee in Zion, Lord, to Thee Vows Paid Shall Be. And you can just think about these words as the music is played. And I don't think we'd get the jail if we just hum the tune quietly. Richard. loving Heavenly Father, we are gathered here in this place just to bring before you all our burdens and lay them at your feet. So all our anxieties, all our worries, all our cares, we lay them before you. And we know in your presence that as soon as we lay the burden down, you carry it for us. But we also bring all our faults and failings, those things we would rather forget, that in your presence we may find forgiveness and healing for our brokenness, wholeness, because of your love and graciousness. We're here also to praise your name, to rejoice in all your goodness, you the gentle shepherd that tends his flock, you the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who came into this world to show us exactly what you are like. And we listen to his words. When we watch him at work in the world, we get a picture of your love in action, touching the poorest, the sinners, powerless, changing lives at every level, and changing our lives too, of course, O Lord God, as we attempt to walk the path of Christ. Because as we walk with him, we become more and more aware of your love working in and through us, because we are your disciples, we follow Christ. So, in our worship, there is praise and thanksgiving, but there is also thought for others, and we will pray for the world as well. But now we draw our prayers together in the words which Jesus taught his disciples long ago. And as we say these words, we claim our place in that circle of discipleship, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen. Now I'm going to read from the scriptures of the Old Testament, the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 34, and there beginning at the fourth verse. It's the story of the end of Moses' life. And God speaks to him. The Lord said to Moses, This is the land which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that I would give to their descendants. I let you see it with your own eyes, but you will not cross over into it. There, in the Moabite country, Moses, the servant of the Lord, died, as the Lord had said. He was buried in a valley in Moab, opposite Beth Peor. But to this day, no one knows his burial place. Moses was 120 years old when he died, his sight undimmed, his figure unimpaired. And the Israelites wept for Moses in the lowlands of Moab for 30 days. The time of mourning for Moses came to an end. Then Joshua, son of Nun, who was filled with the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands on him, he came, and the Israelites listened to him and did what the Lord had commanded Moses. And again, in the New Testament, in the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 16, and there beginning at verse 16. Words of Jesus, the farewell discourses. Jesus said, "A little while and you will see me no more. Again, a little while and you will see me." Some of his disciples said to one another, "What does he mean by this? A little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me? And by this, because I'm going to the Father?" So they asked, "What is this little while that he's talking about? We do not know what he means." Jesus knew what they were wanting to question him about and said, "Are you discussing that saying of mine, a little while and you will see me, and again a little while and you will see me again? In very truth, I tell you, you will weep and mourn, but the world will be glad. But you will be plunged into grief, and then your grief will be turned to joy. A woman in labour is in pain because her time has come. But when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish in her joy that a child has been born unto the world. So it is with you. For the moment you're sad, but I shall see you again, and then you will be joyful, and no one shall rob you of your joy. When that day comes, you will ask me nothing more. In truth I tell you, if you ask the Father for anything in my name, he will give it to you. So far you have asked nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive, that your joy may be complete." Amen. The Lord add his blessing to these readings from his word, in his name, to the praise and glory. We're now going to listen to hymn number 537. Hymn 537, "We Do Not Hope to Ease Our Minds." And the tune of this hymn is a well-known tune, Mary Morris. Joy. Well, The ballots have all been counted and the MSPs have been elected to their appointed task in our parliament. And Monday will be a day of change. There will be old faces missing and there will be new faces in their place. Change. I think change is a word that we use a lot. Just at the moment, we're aware of so many changes in our society. So many changes because of COVID. In fact, as I stood at the door of the church, and it's lovely to do that again and see people and greet people, we miss that. You know, we were talking about the changes that have occurred. So, I'm not going to bore you with any more about the election. I'm sure that you've heard more than enough of it. Yes, winners or losers. The government still has its job to do. Life has still to go on, even if it's changed. And our story in the Old Testament was a story about change. Moses. Moses, who was a great figure, what a character he must have been to be able to deal with Pharaoh, to be able to lead the slave people. Can't imagine just what a slave people are like. Their whole emphasis is on survival. Survival of the fittest. And he had to lead this people, but not just lead them, make them a proper nation. Make them into some kind of community. So we now look at the death of Moses, and of course it would be a time of mourning for the whole people, because he was the one who had led them forth. Moses, stuff of folklore, and we can imagine that over the centuries as people gathered around the campfire or sat around the table, his name would come up and they would remember all the stories of his greatness and power. Man always shrouded in mystery and held in awe. But in the end of the day, Moses was the man who had travelled with them, been with them and shared their hardships, and won his place in their hearts, and led them not just to an understanding of each other, but to an understanding of what God required of them. Commandments. Commandments that were about God and about life, that were wise in so many different ways. You know, when you think about the Israelites, wilderness, desert, whatever, the thing that was important was the journey itself. Not just getting to the promised land, but the journey itself. Because it was in that journey that they learned how to trust one another. It was in that journey that they learned how to be a proper people. A people that were not cowed slaves, but people with pride. People with a self-respect. All the things that make for a proper nation. So the journey was important. The journeys are important. Over the course of the past, it seems like forever, I think it's only 2 years, many people have learned the wonder of walking again, going out for a stroll or a brisk walk to keep fit. But part of that has always been, who will we meet today? And I hardly ever went out in Cooper, but what I would bump into someone at social distance, of course, who would have a chat, because that's what we do. And I think if there was one thing I missed because of the pandemic, it was meeting people. Because people are so much part of our lives, part of our story, part of our history. So the journey itself is important. A week today, I'm going to be travelling down to see my two daughters. They both stay in Northampton, about 15 miles apart. I'm going down to see them. And the nice thing is, when I leave here, and I'll not cut the service, maybe you say, I wish it would. I'm going across to Glasgow, and I'm going to pick up one of my granddaughters, and Amy will help with the driving. But the two of us, as we journey, will blend in, and she'll tell me all about it. She's just back from doing part of her year abroad in Spain and France. She'll be telling me all about this, and all about the folk that she's met, and so on. And the journey as we travel will allow all of that to happen. So the journey itself is an important journey of life. That's how we grow and develop. The journey of life, with all its sadnesses, its joys, its rich tapestry, or I would rather say rich tartan colour cloth. And the wonderful thing about this journey, I'm now probably classified as old, I think. And it's weird because I did get my jag in. But like many other folk, I'm still learning how to consume, learning how to use the internet. What a wonderful thing it can be, and the church is using it. That's one of the good changes, that we're now able to speak to a whole host of folk through modern technology. And I know from the figures in Cooper that when the service is broadcast, we'll maybe get 500 people looking at it. And you'd be lucky on a normal Sunday, in the good old days when we all came to church, a good Sunday would be 150. So it's not all bad. Things are changing. Some of the changes are for the better, and some of them are truly wonderful. Another group that I do Zoom with, Piper's, and they say, there's one from Orkney, but there's another one from Canada. And we can all meet together, play our chanters, badly or well. Wonder of modern technology. So it was, as Israel journeyed, they threw off the shackles of slavery, became our community. And now Moses, the great leader, was dead. And a new challenge lay ahead. And now they had a new man to lead them, Joshua, son of Nun. The disciples, they've been on a journey too. And as we pick up the story in John, they're puzzled, anxious, still mourning the death of their Lord. How did it begin? Interest in this man Jesus? Did they know him before he called them? Who knows? But they were interested anyway in what he had to say. And the more they listened, the more they discovered that this man Jesus gave them some kind of inspiration. He made things different and better. So they started out on this journey with him to the thrill of adventure. But as they followed and as they listened, they also gloriously misunderstood what it was all about. Jesus talked of a kingdom. Well, they understood what a kingdom was. It was all about politics. We've had enough of this over the last few weeks. But that's what they thought, politics. And some of them thought, when Jesus comes into his kingdom, we will have power and wealth too. They had got it gloriously, gloriously wrong. They couldn't understand his willingness to engage with all sorts of people. A poor woman at a well, And he, a rabbi, was content to be alone with her. That was scandalous. And talked to her and listened to her. And a wee foreign woman who came up and touched the hem of his garment. Well, they thought he should be doing more important things. After all, he was supposed to go and cure someone who's the daughter of a very important man. Why waste time on this little foreign woman? But Jesus stopped and again listened to her story. And so it goes on. A woman with oil that bathed his feet, and another woman who was caught in sin. And in the end, Jesus gave her the most eloquent legal defense, as he said, "Whoever is without sin should cast the first stone." And they all just drifted away. They all just drifted away. Yes, but they didn't understand that. How could they? And then the cross was utterly beyond their understanding. That was about defeat and failure and utter disgrace. Only criminals ended up on the cross. They may have misunderstood it all, but yet they understood enough to know that here was someone who had a unique insight into the very nature of God, a unique insight into the very nature of God. So much so that at one point, Peter just burst out and said, "I know who you are. You're the Christ. You're the Christ." That's the good news. The bad news is that when it came to the crunch, Peter, who had said, "You're the Christ," said, "No, I didn't hear him. Nothing to do with me. No, I wasn't one of his followers." And he lived to regret these words, I'm sure, to the end of his days, when he gave his life in the service of this Christ whom he had denied. So now, with the cross and defeat and shame and disgrace, they no doubt thought they were at the journey's end. But the cross, they were to discover, was not the end at all. Because strangely, he began to be with them again, to appear, to be a presence still in their life, a force. And then there was all these puzzling farewell discourses as he prepared them for the ultimate parting. "Your grief will be turned to joy. Your grief will be turned to joy." How could their grief at parting be turned to joy? How many people have lost folk over the past couple of years and grown that deep grief, and not so easy to turn it to joy. We say all the packed easy things, but in the end of the day it's difficult and sore. And it was difficult and sore for them. Time's a great healer, folk would say, but at that point could they see even the infinity of time healing them from the grief that they knew? They didn't realize was that this was not the end of the journey, just the end of part of it, and the beginning of a new and different part. And in time, they would begin to understand. As they remembered the words of Jesus, they would find new and wonderful meanings in it, little phrases that stuck in their mind. Strange that. Words. We just heard the tune Mary Morrison. Norman Cake, I think it was, who said one of the finest phrases in Scots poetry is in that song by Burns. And it's the words, ye are now Mary Morrison. Ye are now Mary Morrison. And in these words, so many things are bound up. The comparison with the splendour of the night and the fancy people there. Ye are now Mary Morrison. Speaks of love and a whole host of things. And just so was the words of Jesus. They would remember little phrases. And as I thought about them, puzzled over them, new meanings, infinitely wonderful, would come to mind. So they would remember his words, and the words would be dead, but new and alive every day as they are for us. And they would remember his actions too, all the things he did, healing in so many different ways, actual healing of lepers and lame people and blind people, but healing at a different, at a deeper level too. And they would see these actions not as just the actions of a good and holy man, but they would see these actions as God at work in his world, redeeming, healing, and restoring. And in time, they would realize that they were not on their own, that their gentle shepherd was still at their side and always would be. Now, you and I, we who are the church, we're facing difficult and changing times. I can't really, as the modern saying has it, get my head around it. So much has changed, even since I retired. I can't understand it. And that's the church changing, and more difficult changes are ahead of us. But it's not the end of the journey for us. It's nearly the end of some of the things that we've known and walking bravely into a new future that lies ahead of us, which will be challenging. But the gentle shepherd will always be at our side, guarding and guiding. Our journey, like that of the disciples, will be very different and often very difficult, but we will walk with God, with Christ at our side. As long as we have hope to share of life renewed beyond the pain, we stand with Christ all through the night till Easter morning dawns again. Amen. May the Lord add his blessing to this preaching of his word, for his name be praise and glory. And now Richard's going to pray for us again. Thank you. Let us pray. Loving God, we bring our prayers of intercession before you, remembering this world of ours with all its suffering and all its pain. Remember especially the troubled places of the world. Yemen, Sudan, we could list many countries where war and violence, bloodshed, is the daily diet of ordinary people. Be with all those who suffer, all those who lose loved ones, all those who know the devastating effect of war. And as we think of that, we think of all the refugees who attempt to leave behind the horror of war, find a new life, and face danger and darkness as they travel on a difficult and often futile journey. And we remember India in the throes of huge outbreak of the pandemic, and again people mourning the loss of loved ones and inadequate medical care and even inadequate means for giving their loved ones a proper and dignified farewell. So be with all those throughout the world who know suffering and pain and loss. Be with the hungry and the homeless. But remind us that our prayers are empty unless we are prepared to be Christ's disciples in our world today. So that where it falls to us to do so, let our hands be outstretched to help. Let our words be the words of comfort and peace. And let our ears be open to those who need to talk. And may we always hold a place for the needy in our hearts. For as we hold them in our hearts, we also hold you, O loving Father. And we pray for the church, this congregation, this ministry, the church throughout our land, the church throughout the world, whether by word of mouth or skill of technology, give the church things to say and things to do that will convince this world of ours of your never failing love and that newness and freshness of life that we find in Christ Jesus, your Son, our God. And we make this prayer in his name, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honour, glory and praise, world without end. Amen. And now hymn number 449, Rejoice, the Lord is King. us go with a spring in our step, a smile on our face, and joy in our hearts because we have been here. And as we go, remind us that we go in a great tradition. And so we give thanks to all who have gone before us in faith. And we praise your name, that they are now in your safety. And now, may the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Christ Jesus. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest and abide with each one of us this day and forevermore.
I don't know what we should do.
Right.
Well, we need to come off because of the weather.